Hi, welcome to Skein & Nerds. My name is Ellie and I am a Norwegian living and knitting in London. You can find me as Skeindeer on Ravelry and Instagram, and I would be very happy if you would follow me there. Welcome back, those of you who have been following me with such loyalty throughout my little time here in this podcasting world, and welcome to those of you who have just subscribed and just decided to watch this weird little podcast. I am very grateful that you have chosen my podcast to watch in this little limited time that you have to allocate to podcast watching, because, you know, we all wish that we could spend all day sitting and knitting and having some kind of podcast friend on our computer screens or whatever you watch them. So the fact that you have, yeah, allocated your limited podcasting watching time to mine, it's so cool. So thank you so much. Hope you will find this worth your time. First thing I want to say, which is really cool, is that I won a cowl. I don't know if you can say that you won a cowl, like I won a prize draw for the colorwork cowl that was hosted by Katie of Inside Number 23 and Marsha of Fairy Little podcast. So there's Fairy Little's podcast that I won in. So they each have their prize draws. They co-hosted it together and they had a prize draw each, and I won Marsha's prize draw for Fairy Little podcast, and so I'll be awaiting that prize soon, and that's really exciting. And it's so cool that it was a colorwork cowl and that it was those mittens that I have designed myself. I'm just gonna put a picture here. So that was really cool. Like, I feel, had I won any other cowl, I'd be like, yeah, cool, I won, I know, and like, but this is like my speciality and my own design, the first one that I've like designed with intent, so that made me really happy. It feels right. Can I say that? Yeah, that's really cool. So thank you, random number generator, and thank you, Marsha, for sending me this prize. And thank you both for hosting this cowl. It was a lot of fun, and I was so happy that it was finally a cowl that I could just naturally submit to, because I always knit color work, so for me to like see that there was a cowl for it, I was like, well, now I can knit this thing and this thing and this thing. And I just submitted and submitted and submitted, and I think a lot of you actually found this podcast through that, because I was like, oh, let's talk color work. So yeah, I could go on and on about that, but I won. I'm happy. Yay. Actually, it was really fun when I just woken up when I watched Marsha's new recent episode, and I was sort of half asleep. I was probably the first viewer to watch it because it was just been put up, and first thing I hear is my name. I mean, Skeindeer is not my name. You know what I mean. So that was, yeah. I was like having to rewind. I was like, did I hear that right? Was that me? Anyway, done with that. It was super cool. And I have now done the draw for my giveaway, because I hit 200 subscribers. Although now we are very quickly approaching 300 already. And I have a few things that I could have giveaways for later on. I don't think I'm going to have one for like each 100 subscriber, but I definitely have something that I think I could host giveaways for in the future. But for now, I have done the draw. So I listed everybody in this Excel spreadsheet, and I added everybody who also promoted my channel twice, so that you had a double chance of winning, but everybody had a chance of winning. And the person who won is Isa Ribeiro. I don't know how to pronounce things ever, so I'm putting it here. And so what she said, and I'm just going to shout this from my laptop while I've written it here. Okay, cool. Yeah. She said, I love all types of yarn, especially natural fiber yarns. I tend to use mostly lighter weight yarn, fingering to DK, but I've used and loved it all. And that's perfect. I had the plan. My plan was to like add more Norwegian yarn into this little gift bag. Hang on, this bag that's designed by Pinnegutti, the needle lady. It has one Norwegian yarn already, and so what I had in mind to add to this skein is lots of Norwegian yarn. And you know what? Norwegian yarn is mostly natural fiber yarns. It's just pure wool, non-superwash, DK to fingering weight. So this is just ideal. I didn't think that these yarn preferences that you guys submitted would actually determine the prize. I just thought, okay, Norwegian yarn to non-Norwegian winners, or something from here to if it just happens that someone who is Norwegian wins, because otherwise that prize is not going to be that interesting for them, because they can get it anywhere. So yeah, the only thing you need to do, Isa, whatever your name is, is to just contact me. You can send me a message here on YouTube or on Ravelry or Instagram, wherever you want, and send me your address so that I can send it to you. I really hope that I can send it to you before I go to Norway, because I'm not bringing like the prize there. So if I can ship it from here first, because I'm not coming back from Norway until the 9th of January, and I'm leaving on Norway on the 29th. So, and I'm also spending most of the time with my boyfriend and his parents. So if you could just get back to me ASAP, that would be super. And if you never do, I will have to redraw from the people who have participated. But regardless, the giveaway is closed. Congratulations. And I'll probably do this again, because it was a lot of fun. And it was super helpful for those of you who promoted my channel. That was really, really great. I'm really sorry if anyone decides to take part between now and the upload tomorrow morning. I can't do anything about that. Sorry you were too late. It's been up for 2 weeks, so... And there will be other opportunities, I promise. I'm pretty sure I can promise that. But from now on, this is not going to be an issue, because I have a Ravelry group. So a lot of you said that you were interested, and by God, I think that was true, because I just created this group like 2 days ago, I think. I haven't announced it anywhere, just made it. And I think when you make a group, it will just appear either if you search for it specifically, or maybe on the most recent made groups, or just in the list of the groups I'm a member of. I don't know where you guys found it, those of you who are watching this podcast and just happened to come upon it, but 8 of you have already joined. What? I just thought like 8 will join in total after announcing it here, and it seems like people were like, oh, it's already here. Did you see that? I'm joining. And like, yeah. I don't have any words. I usually don't have any sensible words to say anyway, and I just talk too quickly. I just want to say thank you. Thank you for showing so much interest that you just join when you first saw it. That's really cool. I'll put up a few threads like introduce yourself and questions and answers. If I answer questions there, I might still also answer them here, or do either or both. I don't know, but those are like the two important threads. I don't know if I'm going to put up a thread per episode, because I always put my show notes here, but you might want to discuss the episode there instead, because the YouTube commenting area is not the best. It doesn't like foster discussion really. It's just like a comment and a reply kind of thing. So can you also let me know how you feel about that, a thread per episode? I know other people do that, so I guess it makes sense. Yeah. So I'll put the link below. It's called Skeined in It. You can just search it up on Ravelry. You can find it on the list of groups that I am a member of. Shouldn't be hard to find at all. And like, let me know what you want from this group, to be honest. I mean, I could draw inspiration from what other podcasters do, but who says I should do what other people do? I probably should though, because people are a member of like 20 to 50 groups, they like to have a certain system to it. Anyway, that's all I wanted to say about that group. Thank you for showing interest. That made me really secure in starting this group. Did someone just shout outside? Anyway, so I had a lot of fun last Friday. I mean, the day itself was really stressful. I'm not going to get into that because personal stuff. But towards the evening, I had planned to go to Pom Pom's Christmas party. And if you don't know, Pom Pom is a quarterly knitting magazine. They're called Pom Pom Quarterly. They come out 4 times a year with knitting patterns. They're probably like, they were the ones, the first I started doing these very modern knitting magazines. I'm ashamed to say I've never purchased their magazine, because while I love it, they rarely contain stuff that I want to knit, but it's beautiful stuff. It's really brought knitting to the forefront in modern crafts and design, and really shows that you can make really, yeah, modern, fashionable, non-dorky stuff like this hat. You wouldn't find this hat there, I assure you. It's a really great thing. Like, two ladies that work, I think one of them at least, worked at Loop in London, and they decide to make this magazine together, and now they're living off that, and it's sort of become, whilst independent of Loop, also kind of like an extension of Loop, that you can sort of spread that loopy feeling around the world. It's really popular, you've probably heard of it, and lots of magazines have popped up lately, like Stranded Magazine and Gone from Norway. that sort of follow that thing. So it's really nice to see that this is a thing now that knitting magazines sort of aspire to be. So that party was a lot of fun. I'm so glad that I went. I sort of realized how many people I now know in the sort of London podcasting world. I need to stop doing things with my hands, honestly. Yeah, I just ran into lots of people that I know from various shops, people who work there, who have the shops, people who go there to knit nights, and not so many from the meetups that I go to independent of the shops. But there were certainly people from Wild and Woolly and Loop who were there, and that was super. And you know, people just so lovely, and you know, this time of year you get lots of hugs as well, so I was just yeah, very happy to be there. And my plan there, apart from hanging out with nice people, was to buy John Arbon yarn. I really want the 4-ply knit by numbers for any cardigan whatsoever. Hand, stay down, honestly. But they didn't have it there. They had some of their Exmoor yarns, and I think they have some alpaca and some other yarns, but not the yarn that I wanted. None of the knit by numbers whatsoever. So, but they were very generous and they gave shade cards. So I'm just going to show you that. This is the Harvest Hue. So they have that yarn there. And I was very tempted to buy this. This little lovely red. It's not going to focus, is it? Oh, look at that. It's a focus thing. So it's called Pomegranate, which is like my fruit of identity. I have a thing where I link people to various fruits, but I can't do it for myself. So this guy was in a band, I really like, decided on Twitter that, okay, well, if I am this fruit, if I'm a peach, then you're a pomegranate. So I'm a pomegranate. So, and apart from that, it's my color to knit with and wear. I mean, it's basically this color. So I really wanted to buy 4 skeins of that just to have, but I didn't. I'm strong. Remember that when I show you where I did buy. But because I didn't have anything from the 4-ply or the other knit by numbers, I ordered their shade cards, and I got an email just now. I have not opened this yet. This was in the envelope, so I thought we could have a little live haul, I guess. I can't tell if it's focusing now. If anyone wonder why I'm like this sometimes, it's just because it doesn't focus if I'm back here. I'm more comfortable standing back here, and I think it's nice to look at, I guess. That sounds rude towards me. But then I can't tell if it's focusing it. It might not actually focus. It's weird. The background should be more blurry. It's not. I don't know. Maybe I'm standing too close to it. Whatevs. I'm going to open this. And look. I also ordered a project bag. It's just a very, very simple one with a logo. I think I even know where you can get these with wholesale. And if you manage to print your logo, you can probably have some of these for yourself. I consider doing that. I dropped it. So just that it has the John Arbon logo on. It's a lovely little logo, and it's so weird that I'm such a John Arbon textiles fangirl and I've yet to actually buy any of the yarns. What I did buy was the this is the DK actually, but it's the shade card for their knit by number yarns. And I got this, I have 4 of these now. They have like pictures of the different yarns, but I like to see yarn in real life. So yeah, so these are my shade cards. Oh my goodness, there are so many things. Okay, so I think this is a sample of the 4-ply. They just gave me 1 sample of the 4-ply, but the colors should still apply across the board. And the 4-ply was just announced in June this year, so that's why I guess it's not readily available everywhere yet. Dear Ellie, many thanks for your web order. Please find enclosed your shade card project bag and 50p refund. And they taped 50p to the card. What? Okay, that's so nice. Why did I get a refund? From postage and packaging. I don't get it. But thank you. I will spend that 50p on something very nice. And these are the shade cards. And I love shade cards. I'm so obsessed with shade cards. I'm expecting some shade cards from Wild and Woolly, actually, in James's and Smith's 2-ply jumper weight yarn. I can order it myself, but we all know that's not a good idea because yarn will happen. But I didn't buy any yarn here. I just bought the shade cards. Do I get a price or something? No, I don't, because I bought other things. Yay. So, just see all the art. those of you, I keep dropping things. So those of you who don't know anything about knit by numbers, it's basically they have a certain set of colors, but these colors come in like, what, 6 shades? So these shades, I just love. I love all of them. It's just, I don't even know which ones to get. I mean, this red is so red. I love that. So the idea behind this is just that I can have this and look at that when I have a specific cardigan in mind to knit. I don't have to be like, but this is my only opportunity to look and squish this yarn. I need to buy it now. I can wait and buy this when I'm gonna knit with it. And you also, you guys are all knitters, you probably know this, that it's really satisfying to buy a knit right away. That's why we have so many whips, I'm sure. When things have been in the stash for a while, it doesn't feel as fresh and as crisp, you know? So here I can have that. It can sort of rest in my little shade card, wherever I decide to store my shade cards. And I can just decide then which shade will suit when I want to knit at that time. Order and knit right away. It would be great. And I don't know when that's going to happen. But it's a nice idea. And it's a way to keep my stash down. Because God knows I need it. So in addition to the shade card by Harvest Hues, we got lots of free stuff. And the sort of pom-pom bags. They gave us just paper bag with lots of things in it. A lot of like just cards of various knitting people. But also a skein of yarn. So some people got a set of minis. I'm kind of envious of that. But I got this. Just like they knew it was for me. It was completely random. And I got this. And it's just, it's my color. And so this is Terra by The Fiber Company. And it's 50 grams, 40% alpaca, 40% merino, 20% silk, 89 meters. And it's half a skein, I think. I don't know why we got half a skein, but a whole skein is worth £25, so this is not, you know, something crappy, I believe. I am, however, a bit sort of hesitant about it because it's like a iron worsted weight something. Feels very thick, and it's a single ply, and it's alpaca, and it's like not entirely my type of fiber. So if I can't think of anything I want to make with this, I might have that as part of a second giveaway. Perhaps along with this. So a friend from Loop, Kate, did not want her skein. She didn't like this blue. So I was like, well, they go really well together. So if I don't feel the urgent need to knit up these, that might be a giveaway in the future for whatever reason. I mean, if my subscription count keeps rising, that might be something on the horizon. Maybe say when we reach 500. And the only way we can do that is if you spread the word. That was kind of cheeky of me, I'm just saying. It's really the only way that I can spread the word because the YouTube algorithms do not favor people who are small. And I don't like promoting myself. I feel really, really awkward. I feel awkward doing it here as well. I'll be like, oh, tell people about my podcast, guys. But that's what really works because you guys tell the truth. So those of you who have been following me from the very beginning have heard me say that project bags are not my thing. I don't get why people spend lots of money on project bags. Although you should support like people who sew and produce stuff. That's nice. And if you like that stuff, sure. But for me, I will just have a tote bag and I'm good with that. Yeah. I've given in. I wonder how many things by the end of next year I will have given in to that I've said now that I'm not into. So I bought a project bag and it's the best thing ever. I'm going to show you now. It's got a skein deer. Okay, so just a regular deer, but because it has skeins inside. Skein deer. And it's got little hipster glasses as well. Look at that. Oh, I just love this bag. I saw all the bags. I'll let you know. I'll put the name here. Those were made, I think they're called Pink Hazel. And they were selling lots of so knitting accessories like needle containers and knitting bags and all sorts of things. Lovely, lovely things. And I saw all the knitting bags hanging up behind them and I was like, there's none of them look like the ones I want. I mean, I love these sort of drawstring bags, but I'm not seeing anything that's me. Like, I'm not going to buy it just because it's practical. I want it to look somewhat nice. And then they pull out this. I love the colors. I love that it has a deer on it. I love this handle. This is genius because I can knit while I walk and stand, which, believe me, I do. But it's coming out of my bag with zippers and stuff. And part of the reason I don't like project bags is because they tend to have zippers, and I don't want zippers anywhere near my knitting. There are some exceptions. If I'm like making mittens, I will take them out and just, it doesn't matter. But for this kind of thing, I can knit while I walk. And I love drawstring bags for other reasons. They're just cute. We'll show you later what I have inside for whips. But for now, just really wanted to show you guys this, how much I love it. It's probably my favorite project bag right now. Either that or the one I got from Pinaguri with all the owls on. It's on the floor, I can't be bothered. But yes, I wish I could make these. When I'm done my degree and I have a bit more time and I can invest that in crafts more so than I do now, I want to get into sewing project bags. Don't know if I'm going to sew garments and stuff like that. I am a knitter, that's my thing. But it would be nice to be able to customize the equipment myself. So I can't really put it off anymore. I've showed you everything I got in the pom-pom party. I will have probably showed you the montage by now, unless I put it at the end of the video. You guys will know. I'm in the past. I don't know nothing. So I have to confess that I did buy yarn there. It wasn't John Alvin yarn. It was something a bit more on the higher end. And oh dear. Just going to take it out of the shelf. So got 5 skeins of these. Look at these colors, you guys. Look at them. Isn't this the most insanely beautiful color combination you have seen ever? I posted these on Instagram a couple of days ago, and I've never had a picture being this popular before. I think people agree that this color combination is the best thing ever, and this yarn is. I should not be pronouncing French, so I'm not going to. I'm just gonna put this right here. I can't speak French to save my life, so I'm just gonna put it here so that you can see for yourself who this is. It is this little sheep. So this yarn is legendary. It's dyed in Paris, so I think it's one of those that's kind of difficult to get your hand on. And I got 5. And what I had in mind when I bought this was either to make this, I think it's a Stephen West shawl that people have been making lots on loop, and it just looks super nice and squishy. I've not really been intrigued by Stephen West shawls before because there's just too much going on for my taste, but those just look comfy and simple, which is weird because I'm not usually drawn to simple either. But I'm not gonna make that. What I had in mind is this shawl that is called Find Your Fade. And it's funny, on Friday when I bought this skein, nobody had ever heard about this pattern. None of the people I spoke to, and I had not heard of it myself until I just stumbled upon it on Ravelry. And now it's huge, and so many people are planning for it and finding their fade and posting the yarn combinations on Instagram. And it seems like most people are going for at least 7 skeins. I just bought 5. I say just, they were not cheap, either of them. So what can I say? I think I'll stick to that though. I'm gonna make that shawl and these. I'm gonna put the picture in here. I'm gonna give it lots of space because it's delicious looking. I don't know if it's like the photo shoot itself or if the shawl is actually that nice. I think it's very nice. And these colors are kind of close to that actually. And these are definitely my colors for sure. This is the most beautiful brown ever. It's so vibrant. And when did you ever hear anyone say vibrant brown? Well, this is it. I only have good things to say about this yarn. It's definitely outside of my comfort zone. You guys know what kind of yarn I prefer. I'm on the solid, pure wool, fine stuff. Well, this is fine yarn. It's hand-dyed merino, which is usually yarn I'm saying, oh god, I hate this trend about fine merino, people knitting only with that. And that's because it's not very durable. You're not making a garment that will last a lifetime and generations, etc. But I'm gonna make a shawl of this. I wouldn't dream of making socks with this ever. It would not be worth the time or money invested. Merino without any nylon, not worth it. In fact, I would argue that sometimes even just merino with nylon is not worth it. I'm gonna show you an example now. These are the socks that I made in Cascade Heritage and Brooklyn Handspun. And Brooklyn Handspun, which is also in Merino Nylon, seem to be fine. But the Heritage is pilling like nobody's business. Look at this. I have only worn this at home, so it doesn't look terrible. I've just been like shuffling back and forth to the bathroom. But it's got this halo all over it. And this halo is about to start pilling now and creating these sort of long lines of pills. Anything that's merino is going to pill, and that's fine. And I'm okay with that. I know the yarns that I have that I made socks off, and it's okay to get these little dots that you can pick off. But when you get this halo, it sort of ruins the whole thing. I still like these to wear around the house, and I'm going to knit up the rest of the skein for my cousin because she's not going to care either way. But that's kind of why I have a sort of hang up about merino. Take this off because it's warm. Yeah, it's still Christmas though, no doubt. We've got Christmas everywhere. So that's what I want to say about merino for now. But for shawls don't get anywhere. It's not like having socks, it's not like having cardigans. They don't, you know, get that friction. So I'm perfectly fine with making shawls of this, and I want to get into shawls because, I mean, if so many people like it, I'm sure it's nice. I'm still going to be doing all my color work stuff, don't have no doubt. But I want to try this. It looks like a gorgeous shawl, borderlining on a blanket almost because it's really big. So let's just look at my yarns again. Oh my goodness, I just love it. So the order I had in mind, I can't remember, but I put it on Instagram. I'm going to add the picture here. What do you think about that order, you guys? Is that good? Is it too abrupt between the brown and the bright one? I mean, I can show you it up close because it's beautiful. It has some of the gold of the skein next to it and some of the brown of the brown skein next to it, so that might just be good enough. I just love to hear your opinion about this, how this will look. Should I alternate it? Should I try striping them a bit together? I don't know, maybe the pattern tells me that I should anyway. Gosh, guys, I'm clueless about this. It's weird like how much I know about certain types of knitting when it comes to this other part, which most knitters know lots about. I'm like, I don't know. So that was the damage done at Pom Pom. Other than that, I had a lot of fun and will definitely go next year and the year after that and so forth. What else? I got some needles in the mail. I got some higher highers. They were not higher sharps. I don't know why, and I don't know why this one looks different. They're all 30 centimeters circumference, circulars, because I need that for socks and stuff. If I'm making male socks, if I can use a slightly wider needle in terms of cable length, I will, because it's less annoying to knit with than the 9-inch ones from Jaegu, although those are the ones I will go to if I'm going to go with 9-inch. But these are 12-inch, 30 centimeter, whatever. They're not higher sharps, but I am okay with that. I thought that's what I'd ordered, but apparently not. Because I poke my finger into the knitting needle for pretty much every stitch that I make. So I have had like little holes bored into my fingers before because it turns very hard first and then it's just, you get a hole in it. So I'm okay with them being slightly blunt. They're not blunt, really. They're still fairly sharp. So let's talk about finished objects. And you can see the finished object right behind me. I'm done with my mitten calendar. I'm done. It's been more than a year. It's been weighing me down. I've loved it, but having long-term whips weighs you down. And it certainly has for me. And these are the only two left to hang up. They're in their little blockers, as you can see. 24th and the 23rd here. So this one will be up by the time you watch this podcast, and the last one will be up on the last day. And these are the blockers that I cut out in foam board, and that was a brilliant idea that Juju from the Knit Nights Loop, she hosts them, she told me about this, and it's brilliant. And I've just been having a go at foam board blockers a lot lately. I'm going to show you a few of the other ones I have made. Made this for a male size foot. You know, they need to be stretched quite a bit, so that's why I decided to go for something huge. So I kind of measured by the large women's size blocker that I have. I went for larges because, again, it needs to be really well stretched, and I went around it and made it a lot bigger. Had to make it a bit shorter than I initially thought I would, but it's pretty good, I think. it does the job. I have already blocked something, I will show you in a minute. I've also cut out some blockers for my mittens, the ones that had issues with blocking previously, and I didn't have any blockers that fit, so I was just sort of stretching them all the time. Which works, you can do that, but because I have such an issue with the fit of these, I just decided to put them on foam board blockers. So now they are still drying, they're slightly moist, at least in the thumbs they are. I could perhaps take them off now, but just holding them against my hand, it now looks like they will fit slightly more, but I am nonetheless going to give them away because a friend of mine from Norway, I'm going to put the designer and name stuff here. My friend in Norway, she wants to give these to her grandmother, so she's just going to buy them off me. And her grandmother apparently has the same size as my friend, who also has the same size of hands as me, possibly a bit smaller. And if she's got slightly smaller hands, these will be perfect, and I think she will love them. I hope so. Anyway, they are just awesome. And it in Roma Baby Panda, which is a merino yarn, but it feels more woolly, you know, when things are super washed, they kind of get this off very glossy cover basically because it's covered in plastic. But these don't have that feel. It seems like they've done the super wash, just the bare minimum of it, the super wash treatment, if that makes sense. I don't know, might make stuff up, but it feels very woolly. And I have another finished object in addition to these. I kind of just want to spend more time on these because they're finally done. I'm just gonna add a little montage as well, filming them all. I'm not hanging them up in the most beautiful way. I might have another go at that later, maybe next year. I'm just happy to be done. And because I'm renting, I'm not allowed to just put nails on the walls, I assume. So, I love them. But I have another finished object as well. So you know that when I refer to advent mittens, I'm either referring to these or I'm referring to these. And they're done. Well, there's still like 3 days, including today, left of this cowl, this mystery cowl. Yesterday told us to make the braids with the two strands hanging down. And I'm like, I don't know how you make a braid with two strands, so I'm just gonna twist them. So I did that. And today we were told to stretch and block them, and I did that last night because I'm impatient. So they're already on the blockers, almost dry enough to go off the blockers, but they fit me beautifully. I'm just going to keep these blockers and use them all on my mittens now, because I've custom made them for these. You can see they have this little slotted thing where the thumb gusset is, and slightly of a soft angle here because I want the cuff to not be so stretched. Well, that should fit just about any Norwegian mitten, really. But yeah, I want to give you a close-up. And I am so happy with the color choice. It's like red on white. That was just the colors I happened to have left of my Ask by Hillesborg. And the white background makes me think of snow, and the red top makes them very Christmassy. Yeah, it was a lot of fun to take part in. Mr. Cals are definitely fun, and it's a really cool advent thing where you get to do a little bit every day. I struggled with the thumbs though, because I ran out of white. So I added Finull, Roma Finull, and I thought this was unbleached white. When it was dark, it looked like that's what I needed. And I have both in Finull, so I was about to add that. And I realized in daylight that was wrong. So good thing I didn't do that. So I managed to find a bleached white of Roma Finull. Added that, and I don't think you can tell that they're a different color. So yeah, I don't know what's gonna be left to do tomorrow or on Christmas Eve. Maybe just taking a photo. No idea, but it's been a lot of fun. I'm very happy I did it. There might be a few things I wish I'd done differently here and here, but other than that, super project. I'm gonna wear these all Christmas. I have these skeins laying on my desk, and these are some Norwegian skeins we got. Some Finull and some Totro Gammelserie, which means 2-ply old series. They are kind of the same, but these have a stronger twist because people thought that they would be good for socks. Apparently I don't agree because they don't have nylon. But I love this, and so I'm giving these 4 skeins away so that my boyfriend's mom can have these for Christmas, along with some translated mitten patterns that I'm still working on. So that's a really nice plan for a Christmas present, I think. So So yeah, working on that. It will be a bit of a stash buster, but obviously I'm going to buy these exact skeins when I'm back in Norway because I love this yarn and I need lots of it. It's just one of those things I feel good about having in my stash. The bottom shelf with my sock yarn and my DK I want to empty, and the top one with all the really expensive yarn I want to empty just to make it worth my money. But this bit in the middle, I'm okay with having it fairly full, apart from the jumbo quantities of stuff, because those I want to knit up just to have those cardigans. So we are gonna finish off by talking about whips. And so most of you will know now that I have thrown myself on the blanket bandwagon. I looked at them initially and I was like, why would people make that? And I'm like super hooked. I want to add squares all the time. And I'm getting the squares from my Opal advent calendar. So I'm just going to show you today's skein. This is the skein that I got today. I'm having huge issues with focusing today. I'm sorry, guys. This is the skein. It's just how we're going to look at it today. Lovely blue. But I haven't knitted up today's skein or yesterday's skein because I'm feeling like my blanket is long enough. I'm thinking of doing 2x2 meters. I asked Arctic Knitting as well if she, the host of that podcast, what size she's doing because it looked nice. And 2x2 meters seem reasonable. It will cover a bed or be nice for two people to snuggle under. So that might just be what I'm going for. And I have 21 squares now, and that should be roughly 2 meters. So I might just stop now. So I don't know where to add these yet. Might just add them just under where that row ends. I'm gonna show you what I mean. So this is what I have. Oh goodness, it's so big. I have to go back really far. So this is where we started, right? First of December, 2nd of December, etc. And the ones on the rows below, I've just added when I felt like it, when I wanna procrastinate for my Christmas gift making. So yeah, it's getting quite long, as you can see. I'm trying to add rows below so that the last three skeins will go just under these. Does that make sense? I really like the last two because this is like gingerbread and this one's like a Christmas tree, and I just thought that was really fun. So yeah, it's just like a horribly awesome looking blanket. It's just a lot going on. I feel like the skeins that are not opal really do stick out though. I kind of wish I had more of those so that I could just like mix it up a little. But I guess that will happen in time when I have all the minis from whatever projects I'm working on. So I am going on a little break with this now. I'm not going to bring it around for Christmas. You're not going to see it in a while probably. I'm not going to add more squares now. I need to finish up Christmas gift making, and it's just not going to be worth bringing along to Norway or to my boyfriend's. Not that it's far away, but I'm going to just stay there and spend the nights there. But it's been a really fun blanket to make, and I look forward to adding more squares all the time. So I just keep everything in this black tote bag, because sometimes you just need a tote bag, and that's where it lives. I might put it into that lovely knitting bag I got for my Secret Santa at work. We'll see. Anyway, that was my blanket for today. So let's return to this one. It's got stuff inside, and I have a hoe. I have a bit more than a hoe, aka half finished object, for those of you who think I'm getting really edgy. This is why I made the sock blocker, because I finished one of the socks. And this is a Serb sock. It's for one of my best friends in Norway, who I've known for 19 years. Oh, that's how long we've been besties, basically. We've not just known each other for that long. We actually know each other for a bit longer, I would say. So yeah, he's gonna get a pair of these. And they look super cool. I tried them on my boyfriend's feet, and his feet are slightly bigger. So if I could get them on his feet, he will be able to wear these. And as most socks do, I'm sure these will expand a bit as well. The colorways are not gonna expand that much, but I should really get into the habit of saying pattern and yarn and stuff. I'm going to do that now. It's by Edoma. No particular designer is mentioned. It's just Edoma. And they have recommended that 2-ply old series yarn, but I'm not doing that. I'm doing drop stable because it's got nylon. It wears pretty nicely for that kind of cheap yarn, and I had lots of it. So there you go. And I've started a second one. It is super cute, and I have my higher on this. I made the last one in Chago, and it is a bit risky to go on a slightly wider needle, but it doesn't seem to pull in any way. It doesn't stretch it out, so I don't think it's going to match her. It's just more comfortable to knit with this because it's got slightly more needle size and just, yeah, more to work on. So I hope to be finishing this sock soon. I should have finished it already, but there's been this other whip that's been keeping me busy that I shouldn't have started really, but I did. So I've started the Spindrift Shawl by Helen Stewart of the Curious Handmade podcast. She designed this pattern and I've cast it on. And before I talk about this shawl, let me talk about the yarn. This is from the Third Vault yarn. It's a UK hand dyer. And it looks so cool. It looks just brilliant. This purple is the purpliest of all purples. And just got like a lot of fandom inspired yarns, but not in the way that they usually are, because usually they go from like the top, you know, they go for Harry Potter and Nightmare Before Christmas and Star Wars, Adventure Time, like this does that, but it goes for the more obscure characters. Like this is called the Architinian, which is a Doctor Who species, creature, but I can't remember the episode. So the fact that I don't remember, even though I watched Doctor Who, says that like it's slightly more interesting in a way. And I also have another skin which is called Thora. I'm assuming it's for the comic book character. So I think that's fun, and I like how it's knitting up. I thought the blue and the red would be less frequent, but it's pretty much all over the place. Let me show you. So yeah, I'm doing variegated yarn, you guys. Scary. But for those of you who have some shawl experience, I'd like to hear your opinion. Because you see the top, I feel like this edge that I'm getting is very tight compared to my shawl. However, it is a crescent-shaped shawl, so maybe it's supposed to be that way. I don't know, I only made triangle shawls and asymmetric shawls. But it's very, like, it's bending over here. And I don't know if there's anything I can do with that. Will that block out? Should I unravel it? I've done 30% of this, which is really neat in the pattern. You get this table that tells you which rows you're working, how many stitches you should have per every row, and how many percentages you are. So it says now 30%, so I know that. And I could also weigh my skein. But it's really nice to just have that. So I'd rather not go back. But I like to know what, if it matters, what I can do about it, if it should be that way. Anything you could say about this would be greatly appreciated. Other than that, I think it's super cool. Yeah. Speaking of Helen Stewart, I met her at Pom Pom Christmas Party and she was lovely. And that's, I just told her that her spindrift shawl was in my queue and I'm going to have a go at shawls because that's not usually what I do. She's like, yeah, you're going to get hooked. It's really addictive to make shawls. And I believe her. It is very addictive. Even though it's got lots of purling and I hate purling, I still quite enjoy making this. And I can see my progress growing with this table that she's got with all the percentages of how far I've gone. So yeah, really lovely meeting her, and that's kind of what prompted me to just cast this on, because I've been saying it forever that I want to knit this. And even the dyer of this yarn, also a very lovely lady who I met, posted on Ravelry about this thing that I had, this skein that I had in my stash and I didn't know what to knit of it, and she suggested this shawl. And I was like, well, I've already thought about making it in that shawl anyway, and if you think it's a good idea, I'm sure it's a good idea. And it was a good idea because it's knitting up lovely. I don't know if it goes with any of my outfits. I don't really do purple or purple contrast colors, but I don't care. It's gonna be cool. So yeah, that was all my shawl rants and name dropping for this particular project. And I look forward to just knitting on this during Christmas. And having said that, I've also selected what yarn to bring this Christmas. This is from Woolly Knits. It's their 4-ply merino, and it's going to be some lovely mittens. It's very similar to the Baby Panda in that it feels very woolly despite being superwash. It will probably not be that slick, and it will work fairly well with colour work. That's all I'm going to say. I have ideas for patterns, but it's a secret. And we got these cakes, and you might recognise this. It's the Outlander yarn by Woolenvine, which I just spoiled myself by buying because it's not cheap getting yarn from the US to here, really. This is gonna be the Duchess of Devonshire shawl, which I am completely copying from Katie of Number Inside 23. 3 because I loved it and she loved it, and so it's got to be good. And I think it will be, alongside with the spindrift shawl, something that will be a comfortable way of learning how variegated yarns knit up. I don't know if I'm going to commit to variegated yarns that much. I mean, I have these skeins that I have, and if I enjoy it, you know, that could be another thing that I do. But if not, then at least I will have a really cool shawl, because I know it's going to be awesome. The last thing I'm working on is Christmas baubles. I love making Christmas baubles every year. They're designed by Arne and Carlos, and so I've made 2. I've not filled them with anything yet, but these are the ones that I have. They're so cute. I'm making them in drop saffron because I think cotton is just fine when you're making stuff that are just for the home. So I should really be making more of these, because I'm planning to gift it to a friend, and if he only gets 2, that's going to be a very shitty gift in my opinion. Sorry if anyone's just aiming for that, but I feel like I need to give more to my friend. So I want to get more done, so that's going to be more stuff for me to do this Christmas. But I enjoy making these, so I'm going to make the bigger ones as well. I've only made the bigger ones before, and now I'm making these teeny tiny ones, and they're super cute. And the teeny tiny ones are free. I don't know if you can get the big ones for free, or if you have to get the book for that. I do have the book, so for me it's not an issue either way. But yeah, just love making these every Christmas. They really bring me into that spirit. And I think this episode has gone on for long enough. I kind of wanted to talk about my year that has been, but I don't think there will be more time for doing that today, so I might do that later, maybe when I'm in Norway or when I have time to make perhaps one more episode before the new year. I'm hoping that I'll be able to do that, because I'm gonna be here the day before I go to Norway, to Gatwick, so to fly to Norway, I mean. So I think for now we're gonna cut it short and talk more later. Yeah, giveaway is done, you guys. It was super fun. It was super fun that you guys wanted to promote my channel. Congratulations again to Isa for winning. Hope you get back to me, and I hope you will all join my Ravelry group. It will be super cool to have you there, and I am very excited and slightly nervous, and I just want to wish you all a lovely Christmas or whatever you do this time of year. I mean, just relax. Let's just knit until our fingers fall off. It will be lovely. And if I don't have time to podcast next week, I hope I will, but if not, have a lovely holiday. I hope the rest of 2016 will treat you well, and I will see you next year or next week. Bye.